Hey math friends, if there's one thing I absolutely love to do with students, it is play review games. I am a natural born competitor. I love the competition that comes from review games, but I have learned that not all review games are made equal, especially when it comes to review games in math. So today I'm gonna give you my top three tips for choosing or creating your very own review game for your students. For those of you who are new here, I'm Brittany Heggie, the math-obsessed educator behind Mix & Math, and in this video, we are going to chat all things review games in math. Now, before we get started, if you are loving this video, be sure you give it a thumbs up, subscribe, and let me know in the comments what your favorite tip is, where you're from, what grade you teach. I would love to connect with you, and of course, if this is helpful for you, send it to a math teacher friend, because what math teacher does not need to know about review games? So when it comes to competition in the classroom, obviously review games are great because they're highly motivating, they're highly engaging, but as I learned a little bit more about math and I really began to stand firm in what I value in our math classroom, I realized that my review games that I was choosing to do with students were actually kind of undercutting everything that I had said throughout the year about what I value as a mathematician for my students. One of our core values in our math classroom is that we do not value speed above all else. Like, yes, we want to be fluent, but just because you can do the math quickly does not mean you are smarter than any other student in the class. And just because it takes you a little bit longer to process things or think through things or work through problems does not mean that you are any less intelligent or that they are any less of a mathematician than the student who can zoom right through things. And so a lot of the review games that I have been choosing valued speed. It was the students who could do math the quickest that were winning the games. And so I was basically telling my students with this review game, a good mathematician is speedy. So of course I didn't want to just completely give up review games because like I said, they're highly engaging and it's a great way to review content, but I needed to figure out how to modify the review games I was using so that they aligned with what I believed a mathematician was. I also wanted to make sure that I was not reinforcing negative beliefs or negative behaviors. Obviously with that negative belief that speed equals being good at math, but then also with that speed aspect, students wouldn't show their work or they wouldn't take the time to really think through something deeply because they were so focused on getting the answer quickly. And so students just naturally kind of have that habit. And so I did not want the review game that I was choosing to use to reinforce that. So I had to make some changes. We know that students' belief about themselves as mathematicians is so very fragile, especially in fourth and fifth grade, when really just students' belief about themselves as individuals anyways is so fragile. The last thing I wanted to do was for something in my classroom to reinforce the idea that they were not a math person. So this set me on a mission to come up with these three tips or these three standards that I set for myself anytime I was either selecting a review game to use with my students or creating one of my own. So let's dive into these three tips. So of course, I'm sure you can guess the very first tip that I have. When you are choosing a review game, make sure speed is not the focus of the review game. We know that we can have two students who have great understanding of a concept, but it can take them very different amounts of time to get to the solution. And so we don't want one student to be penalized when both of them have a great understanding of the concept. I also do not want students to throw all of the strategies I've taught them that support deep thinking. I don't want them to throw those strategies out the window for the sake of a game, like reading the entire problem or checking over their work. And so that is why I just, anything that is speed related as far as review games, I've really tossed out of my review game rotation. Now, if you are doubting that you can have a fun review game that does not have a timer set to it, keep watching because I have got so many great suggestions for you. So one change that we made in our classroom is we actually stopped using Kahoot. Now, there's nothing wrong with Kahoot, but we found an alternative that I really liked better, and it's called quizzes. The reason I prefer quizzes is because you can actually turn off the timer on it. So that means students are not given extra points because they solve something more quickly, and they're not penalized for solving something a little bit slower than their peers. So while there are times that Kahoot would be great in a math classroom, I really prefer, especially if we're having students actually do computation or work through word problems or anything like that, I prefer quizzes over Kahoot. I'm sure there's tons of other options that are not time-based, but I just wanted to give you those two examples and see how they compare to each other. So avoiding speed-focused games really is a non-negotiable for me. But the next two we're going to get into are not necessarily non-negotiables. They're just things to keep in mind as you are planning out your review games. So my second tip for making really engaging review games, but also ones that are just sensitive to our students as learners, is to choose review games where there's not a clear winner until the end. A lot of times students will internalize different things about themselves as learners based on who's in the lead and who's behind. If a student is consistently behind in review games, they may start to have negative feelings about themselves as a math student. And really, it could have nothing to do with how well they understand the concepts at all. They may just be more thorough than another student. So kind of eliminating that who's in the lead, who's behind place allows students to work on the math without the pressure or feeling that comes with seeing a leaderboard. I find that if you are going to do a review game where there's a clear leader or a clear winner throughout the game, it's best if you put students in groups and they're working together with partners. So that way, if any of those negative feelings arise, they're not taking them on about themselves personally because the group is contributing to their position on the leaderboard. I also find that adding an element of luck to review games where there is a leaderboard or students can tell who is in the lead is really helpful because it is not a set number of problems done correctly that has caused a student to be in the lead. It is really just that they chose the right card or the right number of points. So before we go on to our third tip, I want to share with you a review game that I absolutely love that kind of meets this second tip or standard that we've set for review games. So one of our favorite review games, in my mind, I call it the Christmas tree game, and that's because the first time I did it, I actually did it when I was student teaching years ago. And the teacher that I was student teaching under used Christmas trees in the game, but you could do this with anything. If it's Valentine's Day, you could put hearts up. If it is just some random review day, you could put different emojis up. You can do it with any type of graphics, but like I said, in my mind, it will forever be the Christmas tree game. So here's how it's played. So you put students into small groups, and then on the board at the front of the class, you put 5, 6, it doesn't really matter, different objects. You just tape them to the board. Now on the back of those, you write down a point value for each of those items. So if you are doing emojis, so the smiley face will have a set point value, and then the sad face will have a set point value. And so that's how you set up the game. Now each group of students has their own math work to complete during this game. You can really differentiate this in the sense that if near the end of the year, you see that this group of students really needs to work on this math concept, and this group of students really needs to work on this math concept. Well, group those students together, and so anybody who really needs that extra practice with fractions, they will be working on the same set of task cards or the same set of worksheets together. And so you tell students, you tell them that they need to complete a set number of problems. It can be 2, 3, however many you want. And they're going to work with their group to complete those 3 problems. When they've completed those 3 problems, they'll raise their hand. You as the teacher will come to their desk, check over their work. It's really helpful if you have an answer key with you just because this game can kind of move pretty quickly. You'll check over their work, and if they have the correct answers, then you give them a sticky note. Now this sticky note can either be a specific color if you have a bunch of color sticky notes. If you only have one color, totally okay. That group just has a number. So you'll give them one sticky note and they have to write their number on that sticky note. And then once they've written their number on that sticky note, they get to go take it to the front of the classroom and put it on one of the objects on the board. So they'll stick it on, if you're doing emojis, they'll stick it on the smiley face one or whichever one they want. Then they go back to their seat and they start working on the next 3 problems. And so meanwhile, while they're working on the next 3 problems, you're probably over with a different group checking over their work. If they got it right, you give them a sticky note, they write their number, or if it's a color, it doesn't matter. They put it on the front of the board on one of the objects, go back, and they keep playing. So at the end of the set amount of work time that you have given for this review game, you will do a big reveal. So you'll take the smiley face emoji off of the board, you'll announce that it's worth 50 points, and if students had 3 sticky notes for their group on that emoji, then they got 150 points. If a group had 5 on there, then they got 250 points for their group. And so you go through each object, revealing the points. You tell each group how many they had on that specific object, and the kids cheer and they get all excited, and it's wonderful. I always like to have at least one that's 0 and at least one that's worth a whole lot more than the others, because students just go wild. It is so exciting. And so that's it. That's the end of the game. It's super easy to set up. It's highly engaging. And you can see how it aligns to our second tip. Students don't know until the end who the winner is. There's no clear leader throughout the game. And then also, students have no idea whether one group got a certain number of problems correct and another group didn't. It's really a matter of luck, because they just happen to put their sticky notes on the right objects. All right, so here is my third tip for you when it comes to choosing quality review games for your math classroom. So I really prefer review games that are not time-based and there's no outs. So let's start with the time-based aspect of this first. This is strictly for management purposes. I cannot be the only one who has had a review game go way longer than you wanted it to, or that has ended way quicker than you had planned, and then you're scrambling to fill your time. So really the whole time-based review game is just so I can manage it as the teacher. So I really prefer games where I call when it's the end of the game or not. So just like in the Christmas tree game I just explained to you, I could end that game early if I wanted to, or I could end it late. A lot of times I will not put up a timer until it's like the last 5 minutes of the game. So that way I can kind of gauge where we're at and just where we're at on time and make the decision when to end the game. Okay, so let's talk about the whole no outs thing. There is nothing worse than having a student lose and get out, and there's still plenty of time left in the review game, and then we tell them, oh, but you still have to complete the work. Like, how unmotivating is that? Obviously, we don't want the student to just sit there, but I also don't want them to have any less of an engaging time than the rest of their peers, and so I just prefer to stay away from review games where there's outs. I found that review games where students are earning points and then the winner is determined after a set amount of time are really the easiest to manage, and they are still just as engaging to students as all of the ones that are speed-based and where it is time-based and all of that. We don't take a hit on engagement just because we have no outs and these activities are time-based, or these review games are time-based. One of my absolute favorite math review games that I've done with students, I actually modified from the Christmas tree game. It's a combination of that, but it's also a combination of a typical game that we play at a holiday party. You know, the one where you open up the gift and then the person after you can either steal your gift or open up their gift, and then the person after them can either steal the first two persons or open up their own. I love doing that at holiday parties. And so I was like, okay, how can I bring this into the classroom? And so Mystery Swap was born. So the setup for Mystery Swap is just like the Christmas tree game, in that students are in small groups. How you give them work, very similar. You can have everybody doing the same work. You can have differentiate between groups. It does not matter. But here's how we set up the actual game portion once we have students in small groups. So you're going to start by giving every group of students 4 cards. Now, 2 of these cards are going to have a sum of 1,000. You could give students a 700 and a 300, or you could give them an 800 and a 200, or a 500 and a 500. You want to mix it up between the groups, but everybody should have 2 cards that have a sum of 1,000. Then every group is going to get 2 envelopes that have mystery cards in them. Inside those envelopes, the mystery card will have a set value, but students do not know what that value is. You can stay between 0 and 1,000, or you can make it bigger. It's totally up to you, but you just want to make sure students cannot see through the envelope and see the value of the card inside. If you don't have envelopes, you could just take an index card and just put like a symbol on it, and that symbol or a letter will represent a certain point value. So just make sure you make that key before the game starts. So if you do letters, then B has a value of this, Z has a value of this, and students won't know that until the end. So every group of students has their 4 cards, their 2 point values, and their 2 mystery cards. And the way this game is played, again, very similar. So you give students a set number of problems that they need to work through. You go over to their desk when they've completed the problems, and then one student gets to go up and switch one of their cards with a card from another student's desk. So obviously the goal of this game is to have the most amount of points possible. And so one group may take their 200 card and may swap it with another group's 700 card. And so they bring that card back to their desk and they start working on the next set of problems. Some groups prefer to take risks, and so they may switch out their lowest point value card for a mystery card in hopes that it has a really high amount. I have seen students who have all of the point value cards at the end of the game, and I've seen students who have all mystery cards. It just depends on whether the group likes risk or not. So you can see this game is not speed-based. You can see that it's time-based because I can call the end of the game whenever I want. I may give students a 3-minute heads up or a 5-minute heads up, but the game is not going to end until I call the game to end. There are no outs, and really nobody has any idea who is in the lead until the end of the game because of those mystery cards that are in there. And so just like the Christmas tree game, at the end of the game, we have a big reveal and students find out how many points their group earned, and then we have a winner. So I hope this video gave you some ideas of things to consider when you are choosing review games for your students. Of course, not every review game you do with students has to meet these tips or these standards, but they're really good things for us to think about. I actually have a whole bundle of 5 review games that you can grab for your students that align with these standards, that really support the values that we have in our math classrooms, and that don't alienate any student or make them feel less than for the sake of a review game. They're highly engaging, students love them. I've gotten such great feedback from the teachers who have used these games as well, and so I will link that in the description below as well. Be sure to comment and let me know if you have any review games that you absolutely love that I did not chat about in this video, or if there's one of these tips that really was an eye-opener for you. Let me know that in the comments as well. If you love competition as much as I do, I hope you're able to take some of these ideas, some of these games, use them with your students, and have so much fun watching your students review math. Remember, don't forget to like, subscribe, and comment below, and I can't wait to talk math with you again soon.